I think when you're young, you know, everything's flying so fast, you don't realize when you're doing magical things how actually magical they are. We're literally DIY musicians who rode around in a van, and this is the music we choose to play. And somehow it wasn't indie enough, or it wasn't cool enough, and that steeled us to be a completely contrarian unit.
Yeah, I had no expectations other than brutal honesty. That's the way we are with music. He gets the same from us that we get from him. You know, the litmus test doesn't change band member to band member. In the 90s, I mean, we were convinced that the music was born of self-destruction and self-deprecation. Mm. Right? And to come full circle and realize that the music is deep enough to be rerooted in compassion and grace and still be as effective is pretty unbelievable.
But the goal was to see the four of us on a stage. And I was cool if it was going to be one song or a whole show. But she suffered from incredible stage anxiety. And that was part of the equation always. So when you saw her on a stage, she was inwardly going through a lot more than you would have thought, because her stage demeanor was very icy. But inside there was a lot of inner stuff going on.
The show must go on, and stress, everything. Stress. And the business is just nasty.
You know, the moment James Iha walked in my life changed my life forever. The moment Jimmy walked in our life changed our lives forever. Doesn't mean every day was perfect and we held hands and sang around the campfire, but somehow in the midst of whatever our own individual and collective chaos, we were able to make these diamonds that is the shared thing.
Hello and welcome to the Discographers Podcast. I am one of your hosts, Tyler, and with me is my other host, Brian, who is the Dr. Smith to my Will Robinson.
Wait, I don't say danger. That's not my line. That's the robot.
No, that's the robot.
Fuck. Well, hi, everyone.
Perfect.
Nailed it.
Nailed it. First track.
Circle takes the square. I haven't watched Lost in Space in so long, man. I had no valuable reference to add to that. I'm sorry. I really let you down there.
Brian, there was an old TV show. There was a movie. Then there was the new reboot on Netflix.
I didn't watch the new reboot. I haven't seen Lost in Space since like 1999 when Matt LeBlanc was still young and virile.
So, Brian, what are we going to talk about in this episode?
All right. In this episode, we're going to be talking about the first 50%, roughly, of the third studio album from Smashing Pumpkins, Mellon Collie and the Infinite Sadness.
Yes, so it's a double album. We don't have time to cover both halves in full detail and give them all the attention that each side deserves if we tried to cram them both into one episode. This episode would be 4 hours long, and Brian and I don't want that.
I don't want anybody to have to listen to me for longer than the length of our regular episodes. It's sort of a radiation thing. It's not just what the dosage is, but it's the time of exposure as well. It's really for your own protection.
Yeah, and it really, if you try and dive into the B-sides, as I've been trying to do, there's a lot of
songs.
It's
about a week of songs. It's about 1 week of songs.
I made a playlist with the Mellon Collie and the Infinite Sadness remaster with a bunch of extra songs. And then there is a compilation of even more songs that didn't make it on the album called The Aeroplane Flies High. And that was even re-released with more songs. My playlist with both of those together is 12 hours and 22 minutes.
Good
long.
God.
182 songs. So if you write us to ask, you know, hey, what are you going to make sure and cover B-sides? My answer is no.
No. No. I'll probably skim, and if any of them really catch my eye, I might call one out, but
I've tried to listen to, like, I've been trying to listen to as many as I can, and there's a lot of good songs in there, but there's just there's no way to cover all of these, not with what we're doing. I'm sorry.
I'll tell you what, listening public, go tell your friends and family about the show, and if you can get this or the next episode. So I'm talking about the episodes either for the month of June or July. So the two halves of this album, if you can get us up to 2,500 downloads in a month, Tyler and I will each pick five songs.
Okay.
And write short dissertations on them from the B-sides. Otherwise, it will just be us saying, yeah, I liked this one, I liked that one. Yeah. You did that, Tyler?
It sounds kind of like that. Yeah, we did not talk about this before the show, but it sounds good to me. I will verbally agree to it.
I know I kind of threw that one out there, but yeah. If there's somebody you think would enjoy this show, please get them on board. And get us up to 2,500 if you are, like, really thirsty to hear us talk about some B-sides. That's the deal.
Or figure out how to activate some Russian bots and make it happen.
Oh, please don't game the system. Like, that'll give me false hope. I'll think I'll have, like, you know, stranger digital friends that I don't actually have.
The month after that giant peak would be then us going, but what did we do wrong? Where did all those people go?
And then I would be sad. In an infinite sadness.
All right. So back to the
yes.
So the CD sequence is different from the album, the vinyl.
Yes. Yeah.
I think you pointed that out to me before the show.
Yeah. The vinyl was basically broken up into six discs, I guess, or six sides. So three vinyls, yeah. Right? But each side had a name. So side one was Dawn, side two was Tea Time, side three was Dusk, side four was Twilight, side five was Midnight, and side six was Starlight. So sometimes when it's broken up into, just the two CDs, each CD is referred to as, the first half is Dawn through Dusk, and the, back half is referred to as Twilight through Starlight.
Okay, makes sense.
The track order does actually change. There's some stuff that's on one half of the album that ends up on another half of the album. It really, there's quite a lot of kind of shuffling that goes on there.
Yeah, I know that the CD sequence is supposed to be the first half represents day and the second half represents night. I don't know. Yeah, we'll get into the songs later, like, you know, with those themes kind of come out. But that whole idea kind of gets thrown out the window with the vinyl track list, where when I made the track list, I was looking at, like, Wikipedia with the listing and moving the songs into playlist. I was really jumping all over the place trying to find those songs, and it really does feel just jumbled.
I still haven't taken the time to actually put this whole thing in that order in a playlist, and so I'm curious about that. And I think if I do that, I definitely want to keep in mind
the side gaps.
Yeah, the side gaps. I might even want to make treat it like six little EPs, basically.
Yeah.
I don't know.
So that's another way to listen to this.
Yeah. So that's something we can probably discuss even more next month once we've had a little time to kind of do some comparison. But yeah, there was a rather shockingly large difference between those two release media, and that's not a super common thing.
Yeah. So maybe if you have experience with this, you know that you prefer that track listing, send us an email or something. Let us know what you think. And we'll be happy to read that.
And I'm going to go ahead and harken back to our first season here. I would like to challenge any listeners who are willing, along with you, Tyler, and myself, to make a one CD version of Mellon Collie. What's the total track count here? We got 14 and 14, so we got 28 songs. So what's your 14 track version of this? And we can discuss that next month as well.
Okay, I will put that in my homework.
Sorry, I'm having ideas all of a sudden.
Yeah, we have a pre-show meeting and none of this is discussed.
Well, I got excited. Sorry, I live in the moment.
I know, it's cool. All right, well, let's dive into the history of what led up to Mellon Collie and the Infinite Sadness. After 13 months on the road supporting Siamese Dream, Billy Corgan immediately began writing for the next Smashing Pumpkins album. Inspired by the Beatles' White Album, the band wanted the next release to be a double album. Corgan knew that they could easily produce enough content. He said, quote, "We had almost enough material to make Siamese Dream a double album. I really like the notion that we would create a wider scope in which to put other kinds of material we were writing." The band also decided to move away from working with Butch Vig, who had produced Gish and Siamese Dream, and they selected Mark Ellis, also known as Flood, and Alan Mulder as co-producers. Corgan explained, quote, "To be completely honest, I think it was a situation where we'd become so close to Butch that it started to work to our disadvantage. I just felt we had to force the situation, sonically, and take ourselves out of the normal Pumpkin recording mode. I didn't want to repeat past Pumpkin work." Alan Mulder had helped mix Siamese Dream, and at this point Flood had already produced both Pretty Hate Machine and Broken by Nine Inch Nails, Depeche Mode's Violator and Songs of Faith and Devotion, as well as U2's Achtung Baby and Zooropa, to name a few. With new producers came a new recording process. In April 1995, the band began recording in a rehearsal space instead of entering the recording studio straight away. At these sessions, the band boarded rough rhythm tracks with Flood. Originally designed to create a rough draft for the album, the rehearsal space sessions ended up yielding much of the new album's rhythm section parts. Flood also insisted the band set aside time each day devoted to jamming or songwriting, practices the band had never engaged in before during recording sessions. Corgan said, quote, "Working like that kept the whole process interesting. It kept from becoming a grind." The band also used two recording rooms at the same time. This allowed the band to work on separate parts of the album at the same time. For example, Flood and Corgan would work in one room as Mulder, Iha, and Retzky worked in the second. Another departure from past albums was Iha and Retzky recording their own guitar and bass parts. Iha said, "The big change is that Billy is not being the big, I do this, I do that. It's much better. The band arranged a lot of songs for this record, and the songwriting process was organic. The circumstances of the last record and the way we worked were really bad." When the recording sessions concluded, the band had 57 completed songs that were up for contention to be included on Mellon Collie. The songs of Mellon Collie and the Infinite Sadness are intended to hang together conceptually, with two halves of the album representing day and night. Despite this, Corgan has rejected the term concept album to describe it, and was at the time described as more loose and vague than the band's previous records. However, Corgan has also said that the album is based on the, quote, "human condition of mortal sorrow." Corgan aimed the album's message at people aged 14 to 24 years old, hoping, quote, "to sum up all the things that I felt as a youth, but was never able to voice articulately. I'm waving goodbye to me in the rearview mirror, tying a knot around my youth and putting it under the bed." All but two of the songs on the final album were written by Corgan, the closing track from the first disc, Take Me Down, and Farewell Goodnight, both written by Iha, despite being credited on the album liner notes as being written by Iha and Corgan. Iha also wrote additional songs during the making of the album, but they did not make the final cut. Corgan said in 1995 Rolling Stone interview, quote, "There are some B-sides that James did that are really good. They just don't fit in the context of the album. And part of me feels bad, but over the 7 years that we've worked together, the least uptight part of the band has been the music." Next time, we will cover the release and aftermath of Mellon Collie and the Infinite Sadness.
I will be skipping the theory primer this time around, as there isn't really anything that can't be handled in the course of the analysis. That being said, I would like to take this opportunity to let you know that if you have any theory questions about this record or any of the records we've covered, or just generally, if you have questions about music theory, please feel free to drop me a line on any of our social media outlets. I absolutely love talking about this stuff. So, Siamese Dream was an unmitigated success. The Smashing Pumpkins went from the background of the alt-rock scene to the forefront, and immediately became a vast influence on a whole generation of musicians. They had a sound all their own, and it was a damn good one. So, what could they do next? Billy had an answer. More. More songs, more instruments, more weird shit, more everything. And so the Pumpkins set out to make an album that was bigger in both scale and intention than anything they had done to date. Let's see how they fared. The album opens with the title track, Mellon Collie and the Infinite Sadness. It's a delicate, piano-driven instrumental. It is mostly in a D-flat mixolydian scale.
leaning mostly major but with a slight minor pull at the top of the scale to give it a bittersweet quality. This piano part is joined by some synthesized strings, which lend a vintage, imperfect air to the song, and the chords drift a bit out of the scale, making use occasionally of an E chord, which, although it's not in the key, it provides one of the most emotionally charged changes within the song. This short piece doesn't feel particularly grand or epic on its own, but if we take a look at the structure of orchestral music, it can give us some insight into the rest of the record to come. Many orchestral pieces, such as operas and musicals, will begin with a short instrumental piece known as an overture. The overture is responsible for setting the tone of the rest of the show and to welcome viewers into its world. This song, by its very existence on this album, lets us know that the album has grand theatrical intentions and that we should be ready for something a bit more than a traditional rock album. And that leads us very nicely into our second track, Tonight Tonight, which realizes those grand intentions with an actual orchestra and a sweeping theatrical soundscape. Here we see that the guitars are tuned one half step down. The shapes that are played here belong to the key of G, but as a result of the tuning change, they sound in the key of G flat. When guitarists do this, we often will call the chords by the name of the shape we are playing rather than the resulting sound, and this is for ease of communication. That being said, this does complicate things when dealing with a pianist or other orchestral musicians who will often stay in their standard tunings.
Hey, Brian, what's the first chord?
It's a G.
Okay, got it. A G.
No. I'm flat-tuned. It's G-flat.
Why didn't you say that?
Anyhow, for the sake of this review, I will treat it as though it is in the key of G, as that is most likely how Billy, James, and Darcy were thinking of it during the writing and recording of their parts. The song starts with a comfortable and saccharine run across the G and E minor chords, allowing the orchestra to really take the front seat. It then takes a turn through the C, G over B, and D chords. This functions as a bit of foreshadowing, or you might call it a motif, as these are chords that will accompany the chorus later on. It then runs through a restrained verse, which centers around a C major 7 chord and a D 6 11 chord. The second chord is curious because the main notes are D, G, and B, which is just an inverted G chord, but this still functions more as a D chord, and that's a feeling which is made stronger by the switch from this chord to a proper G at the end of the verse. Therefore, I'm sticking with my chord name, which assumes that the F-sharp and A notes of the D chord are implied. For context on this beautiful chord's name, the 6 refers to the B, the 6th note up from a D, and the 11 refers to the G, the 11th note up from the D. The chorus is locomotive in nature, pushing endlessly forward with a full head of steam. Chamberlain's drum work is incredibly deft. The level of difficulty involved with this kind of snare work is not to be underestimated. It is genuinely athletic when compared to a more standard rock beat. The second verse uses a different feel and different chord progression than the first, saving the first verse's progression for the end of the second verse to create more of a sense of movement and variety. In the second chorus, he actually cuts one section a bit short to deliver the chorus's punchline 4 measures earlier than expected. These two deviations are wonderful examples of strong songwriting and Billy's knack for making the familiar sound new. So, a lot of the language of musical terms comes from Italian. There's a couple of Italian musical words that I'm going to go ahead and explain here. There's accelerando and ritardando, or potentially accelerando, depending on how Italian you want to get. An accelerando is when the music speeds up, and a ritardando is when the music slows down. So, here at the end of the song, after a quiet pause, there's an orchestral ritardando walk down to a lovely E minor add 9 chord, which is an unexpectedly dark ending to this gorgeous track. And now for a bit of a left turn with the playfully named Jelly Belly. Wait, it's called Jelly Belly, but it sounds like this? But wait, what? The guitars are tuned in drop B flat, which, as you might imagine, is a lot like drop D, but with everything a half step flat. The intro is an all-out assault from all parties. The whole song is built around quick riffing in the D flat Mixolydian scale. This is one of the most condensed tracks on the record, wasting little time getting to its chorus. In terms of structure, this may be the poppiest song of the bunch. Short, sweet, and packs a punch. Standout moments include a genuinely anthemic chorus. This chorus includes another alt-rock tactic that would be canonized shortly after this. The octave walk-up on the fourth line is borderline iconic. And it's a wonderful moment of interplay between the vocals and the instruments. The end also sees wonderful use of controlled chaos in the form of a chromatic climb that goes for 2 measures longer than you'd expect to lead us into the solo. This track does a wonderful job of presenting a pleasant song in an abrasive aesthetic, perhaps more so than many of their other tracks. Next, we are treated to some relatively straightforward hard rock in the form of Zero. The guitars are once again tuned a half step down, meaning the E minor shapes sound out in E flat minor. Again, for the sake of simplicity, I will call them out in E minor. The opening riff plays a C, B, and E, and then cycles through the available harmonics in the low E string. The pre-chorus makes use of the low string and high octave alternation that Billy has done so often before, but never really in a minor scale, which gives this one a much stronger metal bent. The chorus has a very sing-along kind of quality to the lyrics, which, weirdly, reminds me very strongly of the British invasion bands like the Kinks. All of the lead guitar work in this song is violently chaotic and often discordant, more noise than music, but in the best way possible. This one is also short and sweet, and lands on a simple, powerful, unaccompanied word. With an unexpectedly jazzy turn, we arrive at Here Is No Why. This one uses some more dense chords, albeit still with an alt-rock sound, but this sort of elevates the fairly simple verses of this song to a more sophisticated vibe. Adding to the surprising complexity is the occasional omission of 2 beats at the end of a section so that it starts over a bit early. This happens pretty regularly throughout the song, and if you're not really paying attention, you won't notice it, but it is a slick move. This one is also flat-tuned, and it's in an E-flat Mixolydian, which we will refer to as E-Mixolydian. The opening chord is an A major 7 chord. It's technically outside of the scale, with the G-sharp where there should be a G for the Mixolydian, but the rest of the song is firmly in the scale, so we'll call this G-sharp note an accidental, which is ironically the term for notes which are intentionally out of the scale. During the verses, this A major 7 chord alternates with an E chord. And over the course of the song, he uses just about every chord available within the key, and he's more or less up to his usual tricks. You know, the dynamics are breathing, and the chords go on an adventure, and that's pretty much it, with the exception of an achingly delicate bridge section, which holds on the A chord for its duration. Now would be a good time to briefly discuss the plagal cadence. This term refers to the movement from the fourth chord of a key, in this case the A, to the first chord, or root, in this case the E. The movement is the same which ends many traditional hymns with an Amen. It is therefore also known as the Amen cadence. This is a chord movement that we as Western listeners are hardwired to respond to emotionally. After spending the entire bridge on the A, he finally resolves the next section to an E chord, which is made all the more satisfying by how long you waited on that A. The song gives us another retardando ending, which wraps up beautifully. The next track begins with a bold statement from Billy.
The world is a vampire.
Bullet with Butterfly Wings is a dark, brooding piece which has a metal sound with a serious dramatic flair. Guitars are once again flat, so our key of B flat minor will be called B minor. The neat thing about this verse guitar riff is that he's holding a B power chord shape and then walking the low note with his pointer finger through a B, an A, a B, a G, an E, and an A. This movement in the bass line while the rest holds static is kind of like pedaling in reverse, pedaling being something we've discussed previously where the bass note holds and everything moves above it. This is the opposite of that, but it builds tension in very much the same way, continuously, until the chorus comes bursting to life. The chorus is unique for its six-measure figure. As I've discussed previously, we are trained to hear music in groups of four, so the chord progression starts with a very familiar B minor, G, D, and A, filling up that four-chord expectation that we have, but then it turns around with an E minor and G. That's adding an extra measure, which allows some time for the lyrics to start over without having to overlap themselves. The song proceeds in a comfortable, repeating pop structure until we get to the clean, quiet bridge. Despite all my rage, I am still just a rat in a cage. Despite all my rage, I am still just a rat in a cage. This gentle section lulls us into a false sense of security before Billy screams the word cage in an absolutely brutal roar. Honestly, the song is a fairly straightforward rock song, but it's been turned ever so slightly on its ear, as we have come to expect from Billy. Rather appropriately, the song ends very much unresolved on its fifth chord, the F sharp minor. Now we switch it up with a ballad. To Forgive. This one also features flat-tuned guitars, still in B-flat minor, and we're still calling it B minor. This one is notable for spending most of its time away from its root chord, so much so that you could almost make arguments that parts of it are in E minor and other parts in B minor. However, B minor and E minor only have one note different from each other as scales, and that's the C sharp and C, respectively. The C never comes into play, but the C sharp does, so it's simpler and just as correct to call the whole thing in B minor. It is a plodding, pensive track that holds to its structures pretty firmly. There is, however, a lovely surprise in the middle. It's a climbing section which goes more or less straight up the scale, but lands with stress on various different chords on the way up. A, F sharp minor, D, B minor, and finally on G to start the next section. Now this is a fun math trick where they go up 6 notes out of the available 8 in the space of 4 beats, and we land on a different chord every time. This is not something that's super noticeable when listening to the song unless you're paying very close attention, but it is a really slick move. Fuck You and Ode to No One starts with menacing guitars, and while it is relatively calm, there is an overwhelming sense of something about to explode. again flat tuned, we will call F minor as F sharp minor. The key is vaguely minor, though Billy does lean heavily on that major note in the melody. This is just for flavor, as the rest of the track is pretty squarely minor. Call it blues if you like. When the track expands into its next section, it's properly rocking. It leans very heavily into a syncopated riff. Which circles around the F sharp minor chord. It runs along a fairly simple structure until it reaches a start-stop riff, which kicks all of the ass. There is a strange section which slows down in tempo, but just for a brief, tense interlude. Coil my tongue around a bumblebee mouth, and I give it all to you. Before speeding back up to pin us to the wall before a blistering solo hijacks the whole song. The chaos continues until we are again visited by the start-stop riff, which seems like it will end along with the solo, but then it gives us one more slap in the face. And then a huge E chord to ring out on. Let's talk about love. While I don't want to constantly compare songs to the previous artists we have covered, this is the most Nine Inch Nails-esque thing I've ever heard from Billy. And perhaps that's not surprising, given that the production team on this record are a couple of Nine Inch Nails production alums, Alan Mulder and Flood. This one has a vibe that I might describe as kinky and or dirty. Everything is behind some sort of filter or another, whether it be the phaser that's on the guitars or the distortion that's on the drums and the vocals. It's just gritty. Flat tuned once again, we are in G minor, calling it G sharp minor. This one is fairly simple, but has an interesting turn in the chorus, where the first, second, and fourth lines start on a G-sharp minor, while the third line has the same progression, but substitutes the B chord at the beginning, providing a major turn, which helps to soften the granular sound of the song. Now, they don't follow that same pattern every time that they do it. It varies over the course of the song, but that's sort of the basis of that particular idea. The song ends with another ritardando, although I think this one may have been accomplished by digitally slowing it down, based on the sound of everything sort of stretching and breaking apart at the end. Now, I've got no way to verify that. I know that at that point we had reached the advent of digital recording. I'm not sure if they were using it for this or not. However they accomplished it, they absolutely created a unique sound, and at least in terms of this album, the song sure is different. And speaking of different, let's go from the grainiest song on the album to the most crystalline. Cupid the Lock. You may be wondering if it's flat tuned, and it is. We will call E flat as E. The verses mostly revolve around an E major 7 chord, with various harp sounds and synth textures creating a delicate dance. The chorus is brief, but it provides us with a minor turn to offset the sweetness. I mean, this is Smashing Pumpkins after all. There's not much trickery present here. This one is drenched in reverb and echo on an album which has been mostly dry and gritty. And it stands out as a beautiful deep cut on the record. Now we travel to the islands of Galapagos. This is another pretty track, this time in the key of D. Just kidding, it's flat tuned too, so really it's D flat, but I don't care, they're playing it with these shapes, so fuck off! The opening riff alternates between D add 9 and D major 7. It's this sweet, sophisticated, serene sound, where it's basically one chord, but it's really moving to a lot of gorgeous, colorful area within that chord. The verse alternates then between a D and a G. That's that plagal cadence, remember, when it goes back from G to D. It's the 4 to the 1. And this gives it sort of a heavy, reverent lilt, right? You know, it's still this light, beautiful song, but there's something more going on here. The chorus is more fraught with emotion, rolling through a B minor, an F sharp minor, an E minor, and a G. And it pointedly avoids the root note, and that supplies way, way, way more tension. It repeats these sections, and then there is a lovely section featuring a twin guitar lead. But it's a much mellower context than Pumpkins usually provides us with twin leads. That carries us into a fuller section with some gorgeous theatrical chord changes. They start off simply with the D, A, and G, very folky changes, but right after that it takes a dramatic turn by, in the last measure, taking us through a B flat and a C. This briefly alters our scale to D Mixolydian flat 6, but it's so brief it's more of an accidental rather than an actual change to the key. In any case, it's one of the best moments of the song. The track quietly sees itself out, wrapping up more or less where it started. Now for Muzzle to come in and bring the energy back up. It's in A flat Mixolydian, but we'll call it A Mixolydian for reasons which I hope are fairly obvious at this point. Especially after the last couple of songs, this one feels very familiar and normal. And by Billy standards, it is fairly simple. It isn't attempting to challenge, but rather it seems to comfort. Even though it's a more aggressive song than those that preceded it, it feels more like home on this record. I actually feel like it loses something by its placement within the album. It's surrounded by interesting and odd sounds, and by comparison, it almost feels kind of bland. But I took this one for a spin out of context, and it's a great song. It's full of feeling and very effective, but there's nothing tricky going on here. It's more like, here, you've sat through our more weird experimental stuff. Good job. Have a cookie. And time to get weird again. Porcelina of the Vast Oceans. This is a track which is as sprawling as its titular oceans. It starts off imperceptibly quiet as it reaches upward for a gentle beginning point. It alternates between an A add 9 chord and an A minor 7 chord. By this point, you can assume that those are actually an A flat add 9 and an A flat minor 7, but I digress. This puts you in a very vague sort of space, not knowing whether it should be major, minor, happy, sad. And it kind of keeps you guessing. This builds steadily with some delightful cymbal work from Chamberlain and various synth and guitar textures to supplement. Now, this portion goes on for long enough to make you feel secure, safe, even. And then the song yanks the rug out from underneath you. Here is possibly the biggest wall of guitar on this entire record. Riffing around on octaves and open strings, as is his custom, for a truly huge open D chord. This hits with such impact because of the quiet section from which it unexpectedly springs, but honestly, I think this riff would still sound fucking massive in any context. After the riff-based portion, it walks up from an A chord to a C chord, and that plants us in D Mixolydian. The riff comes to an end, holding on a G chord, and we get to breathe for a bit. The verse carries through a kind of Pink Floyd-esque D, A, C, and G before it tees up the atom bomb of a chorus to explode back in. And then it takes us through another Floydian section, with a soaring but subdued solo, laden with odd sounds and textures. We then take a gentler pass at the verse, crash back into the chorus again. They kick it up one more notch for a huge bridge and an aggressively phased run of riffing guitars, playing a permutation of the chorus riff. We then descend into a moving guitar outro, which is equal parts reverb and feedback, which washes over us as the song fades out. I usually hate when songs fade out rather than just end, but this one feels pretty damn well earned. Lastly, we have a gem of a track written by the venerable James Iha. It is all fairly green light, without any real tricks. This one is all feel, subtlety, and atmosphere. With different instrumentation, this could be a late 70s love ballad, but it is saved from that instinct by the prowess of the musicians. I love that they end this half of the album with something so simple and pleasant and delicate. So, we aren't even done with this album. We're 14 tracks in and we've got 14 more to go. And already, I think they've achieved their goal. This album is more. More sonically diverse, more grandiose, more ambitious, more carefully written, more obsessively arranged, more unapologetically challenging. It is just plain more. Whether this album will sit more prominently in the hearts and minds of its listeners than, say, Siamese Dream, that's really up to the listeners. But this half of the album shows heart and skill in equal measure, and I cannot wait to dig into the next half. See you next month.
So, yeah. That's kind of how I feel about the first half of this record. But, Tyler, what do you think? Think we should take a look at the songs?
Yeah, let's talk about the first song, which is called Mellon Collie and the Infinite Sadness.
So, right out of the gate, I'm seeing some thematic cohesion with the album, and I'm loving it.
They definitely got the name name brand out.
Absolutely.
There.
Absolutely. They went right in for the title. I'm not entirely sure how I feel about this opening track. I love having an instrumental opener on a record. I like that as a feature. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the kind of contrast of going from this directly into the next track, you know, the next track is very fully orchestrated and this is very sparse. And I understand that's kind of fun. Like, it grows into the next mm-hmm. song, but
yeah,
some of like the string sample stuff is just almost a little too cheesy for me, but I really like the piano work on this one. I think it's puts me in mind of like a 70s like yacht rock ballad, like, you know, like, okay. Yeah, but like in a good way.
So if you listen to these in order, like kind of what we've been doing, you go to Gish, you do Siamese Dream, and then you put this on. It's this and the next song are very different from what we've seen so far in the first two albums. So I'm
much more softer, yeah, more softer. That's grammar. Much softer. And sort of more focusing on like the melody and the beauty.
Yeah. And cause I mean, this is a double album, so they have more space to play with, mm-hmm. you know, we'll do a longer intro credits, you know, something like that. We've got the time. So yeah, I enjoyed this for what it was. I was listening to this. I was kind of like, all right, but when did the Smashing Pumpkins come on?
Yeah,
I'm ready for that band that I know from the last two albums.
And so not to like heap criticism on it or anything like that, but it sort of functions as a, you know, fun, kitschy, weird little intro, and I almost just wanted it to be weirder or be more full, if that makes sense. Like,
sure, it kind of does. Yeah, there's no vocals. It just kind of does the same thing through the whole song.
Yeah. But it's a pleasant thing that it does, and it leads us directly into...
Well, before we go directly into...
Oh, goodness, do we have liner notes? Yes!
We have liner notes from the 2012 remaster, where Billy Corgan gives us insights into all of the songs. So, the...
This is... How many of the albums has he done this for? I don't want this to stop. This has turned into, like, my favorite part.
I need to double check, but I think this is the last one.
Oh, that makes me so sad. All right.
So he says, 1994, I brought home a newfound relic, a 1920s piano that sounded somewhat dull and sentimental to my ears. Having chosen in sound what I also overlooked in the flat harp's poorly mismatched legs, far up in the front parlor of my fresh-painted Lady Victorian, I hacked away, believing that in doing so, I was playing my part in a beautiful dream that now come true. Newly married and sitting out my mornings on the sloping arc of the window bay, I reached out into a once grand boulevard, keeping time with the sway of the dancing trees, and this is how I taught myself to play my original instrument of choice, by inventing small partitas. This little train was among the best that lit the way. Yep, that's what he has to say about the song.
I think that one stayed salient much longer than most of the other the ones on the previous ones here.
He does say, he also says that about the name itself, the Mellon Collie, Infant Sadness, that, you know, is also the name of the album. This ever curious name came about years before its necessity, hatched as it were, as I walked about the rusted grounds of Coney Island in what was a bracing spring day circa 1991. Once received and noted within, I auto-hypnotically blurted out the title into the air, hoping that by sharing it, I would better recall its odd canter later on.
There we go. Yeah. So another one of those ones where he's just kind of pulling it out of the ether. It's interesting that he refers to writing little partitas. Partitas, mm-hmm.
Yeah, what is...
It's a classical music term. It comes from the Italian for part. Like a...
Okay.
Typically...
Because I thought it was like a taco or something.
No, typically it's like a suite of music for a solo instrument. Bach has like cello suites, which you could call partitas. Mm. There's probably a good handful of recordings of one of my favorite musicians, a guy by the name of Chris Thiele, playing a lot of Bach partitas on mandolin. So it's
kind of in that vein. And it does kind of fit that classical music
style. Yeah, it's certainly not violently complicated and passing notes the way that Bach sometimes is, but like it's got a very just correct sort of sound to it. Nothing's particularly challenging. He does kind of throw in some weird notes every once in a while, just so you know it's Pumpkins, right? So he'll throw in a couple to be like, hey, it's still me.
It's still me. Billy here.
Yep. It's your old man, Billy Corgs.
All right, and now we can transition eloquently into Tonight.
All right. Well, I've got feelings about this one, but Tyler, why don't you go first?
So this is one, this is another like single that I was very familiar with because of radio play. And so this is a great song. I don't think I'd ever heard it with the Mellon Collie and the Infinite Sadness track preceding it. So that was really cool just to go from this very beautiful song into this other very beautiful song that I'm very familiar with. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a cool, like, oh, I never, seen the intro to this song. So it's kind of cool.
Yeah. I think, they almost work better as a unit. I love Tonight. That one's not, that's not new. that's a great song, but getting it that way with that buffer is nice. I like that a lot.
Yeah, definitely. Do you want to hear what Billy has to say?
Yeah, sure.
All right. So Designed from the get-go as a mod throwback, Tonight started out in a far lower key, lacking then the time-cut verses that became its most recognizable signpost. The tune lingered around the edges of a whole host of ideas until by chance I heard an orchestral fire in the aching changes, which in response made me only want to lift the key from a tidy C to a proper and more epic G major. It was suggested then that we hire a proper arranger to make quite clear the mirrored song to lay with lay on its twin. And that's how I came to spend 4 days of my life being told the quote for what classical types would and wouldn't play as written. The string session itself was a harrowing affair. 30 foreigners on our rock and roll turf stuffed into the longwise expanse of two studio chambers. One noble scruff pulled me aside and said, "Did you write this stuff? It reminds me of Maher." Lyrically, there were a few nods to Cheap Trick and Yeats, but the message I scrawled out was mine alone, rare in its direct honesty.
There we go. I had actually caught portions of that on some of like the Lyric Genius stuff that comes up when you're listening to that song on Spotify. And I love that whole thing about the orchestra, right? Because as much as he talks about them being foreigners on their rock and roll turf, I've dealt with a handful of people who play classical, and you try to bring them in to play something a little more rock and roll, and like as many of your rules as they are breaking, you're breaking the same, right? There's plenty of things, hard and fast things that, you know, they're sort of taught not to do. Like, don't play parallel fifths, you know, just these little maxims that we don't really incorporate into rock. And that's where some really cool things happen, is when those two
worlds kind of meet.
Absolutely. Yeah. Because you end up getting the sound of rock and roll, but with a different voice, right? That's the best way I can describe it, I guess, is just that, yes, they are violins, but they're not playing what a violin would normally play, right? That sort of thing. And that,
right,
that lends this song just a really, really epic air, and I love it.
Yeah, I mean, other than Billy Corgan's vocals being on the track, this doesn't sound like anything that we've heard from Smashing Pumpkins yet.
No.
Which is, it's a really cool song.
Yeah, it feels very much out of left field after Cherub Rock, or rather, after Siamese Dream, just because that one was such a compressed rocker, right? You know, it was just like, hey, yeah, we're gonna do a lot of rock songs, and we're gonna do two soft ones, and this is just something different. This is something very energetic and very bright and almost happy in a sick sort of way.
Yeah, almost. And yeah, lyrically it does talk about, it seems like it's talking about giving up the youth that you had as you grow older. You know, life can change, that you're not stuck in vain, and then looking at the future with hope.
Yeah. So a bit bittersweet, but I'd say, you know, definitely on the positive side. There's one line in particular that stuck out at me, and I think what's interesting, this is one of the first songs from them where the lyrics did jump out at me more than just sort of blending in with the instruments. And the line was, "Believe in the resolute urgency of now," which I feel torn about this, right? Because part of me is like, okay, you're writing this to sound, you know, cool and philosophical and interesting. But he sings it so earnestly that I'm like, well, maybe you are cool and philosophical and interesting, you bastard. You know? You know, so like parts of it do feel a little bit contrived, but it really works in the context of the song very, very well, I think.
Yeah. Did you have a chance to watch the music video for this?
No, I did not. I heard that it was something to behold, though.
It's pretty cool. It's kind of like, it's shot in kind of like a turn of the century movie of like, you know, those black and white silent
kind
films.
Kind of hand-cranked camera.
They get on their dirigible and they fly up to the moon, and a couple jump out and they're tumbling, and then they open up their umbrellas and they float down to the earth, but on the moon, and they meet some like moon men, and they like get captured by them, and they escape on another rocket that's magically there. But then when they get back to Earth, they crash into the ocean, and then they have there's like the underwater people, and it's all silent film style. It's really cool.
Yeah, I'm kind of thumbing through it on YouTube right now. It actually looks really cool.
I've tried to watch all the videos for all the singles so far, and a lot of them kind of come, at least the first two albums when they're early on, they don't have very much of a budget. They tend to look a little dated, mm-hmm. of like, okay, yeah, this is early 90s. You know, just kind of how things are. But this one seemed really timeless.
Yeah.
It was like intentionally cheap or intentionally lo-fi.
Yeah.
So it kind of has a timeless quality about it. So yeah, I thought it was really good.
Yeah, I think it actually plays very well, to be completely honest. Mm-hmm. Just from the bits that I just looked at, I dig.
And Billy is kind of smiling.
Yeah, yeah. He almost looks happy. He doesn't look like a sad boy.
You just called Billy Corgan a sad boy.
Yes, I did.
All right. Sorry, Billy, if you listen to us.
I didn't necessarily mean sad boy in terms of spelling B-O-I at the end. But so many of the songs have been so sad.
Just remember, hashtag Brian, not Tyler.
Brian, not Tyler, at thediscographers.com.
When you want to send your...
I'd tell you to find me on Twitter, but I don't even know what my Twitter handle is at this point. So.
All right. Well, let's move on to Jelly Belly.
Okay. Hard left turn.
Like, this is Smashing Pumpkins that I'm used to from the last two albums.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Complete return to form after Tonight. A little jarring for me, really. Mm-hmm. But I'm not necessarily mad about it.
So, Billy says... A nihilist manifesto thrown like a pink hand grenade into an alley. I just went road shotgun with the images it sketched out nicely, the gray of my suburban years. The original riff dates back into 1992, where we spasmodically played some of the concoction of the song as if there was nothing else to jam in the third encore. To spice things up, the machine gun bit was added to chop up the monotony on the back end of the blues. Once we flipped the script to bring in the rat-tat-tat up front, this led to far more excitement. Sped up tremendously, a Teutonic maelstrom emerged until there was a starship waiting without a single lyric or melody to accompany it into space.
Okay, so we're kind of
so
back to...
How much made sense? Yeah?
I'd say the ratio is reversed from the last one. From the first one, rather.
he used up all of his clarity at the beginning.
Absolutely. And then he had to start using his acid instead. Sorry, guys. I'd like to start by apologizing to our faithful listeners. I like to make jokes about Billy being on drugs, and that's pretty fucked up, if I'm completely honest. Just don't expect it to stop. I respect what the man does.
Yes. Yeah. We do enjoy the band, even if we... poke fun at things. All right. So yeah, it's a cool little song. You know, it's what I would consider to be classic Pumpkins sound.
I would say it's maybe just a touch more chaotic than just about anything they have leading up to it. Specifically that intro. it moves so fast. But it definitely feels on brand.
I do like the last chorus. It has an interesting breakaway from the previous lyrics, going from "you're nowhere to see" to "you're forever to be." So kind of switching things up there. Mm. That was cool. Corgan wanted this to be the original first single. So he said that "Bullet with a Butterfly Wings," which we'll talk about later, was the obvious first single. Mm. Choice, which is why he didn't want to do it.
Sure.
You know, in Pumpkinhead, we don't really like to do the obvious thing. I felt really close to Jelly Belly because it sounds to me like a classic Pumpkin song from a third album.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it really fits that bill very, very well. Like, it's not to say that it's without challenge, but I feel like it's like comfort food.
on this album, if that makes sense. It's what you came here for.
All right, I want to move on to Zero.
Zero is pretty darned aggressive, but it's got this sort of almost happy, kind of punky rhythm to it, right? Like, it doesn't sound that way, but, like, the energy with which it moves forward is almost sort of bouncy, and I find that kind of interesting, where it's you know, the tone and the speed are sort of not a normal pairing, and it makes it kind of interesting. I dig it.
Yeah. I know that I've heard the song a lot before getting into this for this episode. So this was one that I was like, oh, sweet, Zero. I know this one.
Mm-hmm.
It's in the same kind of zone as Jelly Belly. So it's what I expected from Smashing Pumpkins.
I will say that this one, is a little bit more directly dark than some of their other stuff, right? Mm-hmm. Like, a lot of times they kind of pop a little major, a little minor, and this one they stay pretty minor for the most part. So it's like, it's a little more like straightforward, like rock and roll, like vaguely metal.
He actually did have a quote in Guitar World at one point where he says, we like to call this style of music cyber metal. Zero has 6 rhythm guitars, 2 line-in string acoustics, plus those wacky James Iha leads, tracked live with overdubs added later. This is a true mover, as well as the first song that was recorded for Mellon Collie. James has said this always reminds him of Judas Priest.
Yeah, I can see it. It's got that kind of crisp metal flavor. It's just been mm-hmm. pumpkined.
Yeah. Pumpkin metal.
Pumpkin spice metal. Wait, sorry, no. No. Oh, I wish I'd never said that out loud.
All right. Do we want to try and decode? You got your decoder ring for this one?
Yep. I think I'm going to need some more whiskey before the one after that. But let's...
All right. I've been stretching. All right.
All right.
For the first time in my life, I had a room solely devoted to nothing but the creative act. Into Spartan emptiness, I placed a few rudimentary pieces of recording equipment. Sitting atop passed-on handmade furniture nobody in my family wanted, the ancestral code conveniently painted on its black decades before me. The room had once been victim of fire, and when it was hot out, you could still smell the charred timbers. From there, I traced 2 demos, made 5 minutes of one another, the first bearing the opening maw, but with a different second riff, whilst Tugeland lacks the imbued menace of the first. I presented the complete architecture of the song to the band that following afternoon, which happened to be my 27th birthday. Happy birthday.
Yeah.
If one believes in myths and unicorns. I did not know then that I would become the song, and the song would become part of my assumed identity. Curiously, I also find in the reflection a devastating first shot at my bandmates in amongst the carefully sharpened lines, one early indication that I was souring to what I saw fallaciously coming down the pike. The tossed missive, God is empty just like me, brought God-fearing and hell-loving out to hound me for years in various backstage parking lots, trying their best to convert me to a God and Savior I was already sold on. Most seemed disappointed that I didn't put up more of a tenacious fight beyond my saying one lyric does not make a man, nor does show the depths of what he believes in his heart.
I feel like more of that one made sense, although some of it was veiled.
Yeah.
So, 27th birthday, if you believe in unicorns and myths.
Yes.
He's got to be referring to the 27 Club.
Oh, yeah, the Kurt Cobain.
Kurt Cobain, Amy Winehouse, Jimi Hendrix, Janis Joplin, maybe a bunch of people who died, was it before 27 or at age 27?
I think it was like in their 27th year. Yeah,
died at the young age of 27, so maybe he thought he was reaching the end, I don't know.
Yeah.
But I mean, in light of the fact that just one year before the album came out, about a year and a half before the album came out, is when Kurt Cobain made his exit.
Yes.
That there's something kind of prescient, or prescient's not the word, but poignant about that.
Yeah, and this was written in 2012, so you know he had that to look back. Sure. He's looking back.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think it would have been a little callous to write something like that right after that happened. But in retrospect, true. There's something
yeah.
to it.
So yeah, and I did think it was interesting to have like the clarity at the end there with the mm-hmm. The God is empty, just like me line.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
I don't really have much else to say.
That was one of his more explanatory liner notes. That one was actually pretty much chock full of stuff.
That was fairly useful and informative. Thank you, Billy.
Still entertaining in its own right, though. Never change, Billy. Yeah, I mean, I don't have much to add on that one other than it kicks ass. You know, it's a hard-hitting song.
Yeah, I know that the whole this... You know, he would wear, when he's playing live, the black t-shirt that says Zero on it. Like, this was a big reference, a big iconic thing for him.
Yeah. Yeah, this song was very important to him. And it's, I guess the other thing I can say about it is that this song is one that has really made its way into the arsenals of new and starting guitar players who want to play in this style. Because it's one that can be played physically pretty easily, but is a cool sound. That whole opening riff is only played on just a low string, mostly by basically dragging your hand down with varying levels of pressure. So it's a more advanced sounding riff that is easier to play, which makes it very inviting for new and aspiring players. So, I mean, in the 6 years I was teaching music lessons, this saw heavy rotation.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we want to move on to Here Is No Why.
Yes. So, for whatever reason, I'm reminded of the band Local H. Song is called Bound to the Floor. They don't sound alike at all. It's just like this is sort of the slow major key version of that song. Like the chords, for whatever reason, kind of remind me of each other. This one's it's got a bit of a jazzy bent to it.
Yeah, it's a kind of a fun little one. So let's see here. You want to know? Do you want to know some liner notes?
Yeah, I mean, do I ever? Right. Here is no. Right. Why is it called that?
Well, the first line starts with the title was appropriated from an article I read on the anniversary of the world's first nuclear attacks. A survivor, in surveying the legacy of near total destruction, had remarked in broken English that here is no why. Looking at the twisted remnants of my own childhood memories, I felt a similar sense of loss amid my confusion. To hide some of my sorrows, I couched these thoughts into glammed-up tart that rings neither happy nor sad. In some respects, the song doesn't fit well amongst the others, being too maudlin for its own good and too strident to take full advantage of its T-Rexian strut. But like its author, the Death Rock Boy, its most glaring defects are part of its lingering charm.
Yep. He just referred to himself as the Death Rock Boy.
Yes.
Yes, of course. I mean, of course. Interesting, the heroes know why. That's not a quote I'd heard before, but Hiroshima, right? The idea of, like, there aren't reasons here. It's just...
Yeah.
It happened. That's pretty heavy.
Also, I think the most coherent notes, like the most informative, like straight up, like, I mean, the most ambiguous, weird thing was the whole Death Rock Boy, and that was made very much sense to me.
That also felt remarkably tongue in cheek, and I love it.
Yeah, I thought that was great. But yeah, in terms of like theme and lyrics, like I feel like the song is about the grinding away in the fame machine, like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the makeup fades and one loses sight of the dreams that they had at the beginning. Like, it's just like, why am I doing this kind of a thing?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I think there's that's a recurring theme throughout rock is, you know, eventually somebody will write a song about the strain. And the people who write those songs really well receive the love and pity of the audience. The ones who write them poorly seem like, okay, well, what are you whining about? And this is one of the ones that's written better. I think this one has some underpinnings of what would become indie later on with these sort of like jazzier chords in this rockier context.
All right, let's move on to Bullet with Butterfly Wings.
Now, we had some talk last episode about most recognizable pumpkin song. And I was thinking, Cherub Rock today.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of forgot that this one was existed. I think this might be the one. I think this might be the, if you haven't heard any other Smashing Pumpkin song on the radio, it'd either be this one or Disarm, probably.
I would say either this one or Tonight.
Sure.
Tonight.
Yeah.
I think Tonight's maybe more in the accessible stations.
Sure.
Kind of a thing.
Yeah.
It could be easily played everywhere, or more easily played everywhere. But this is definitely, prime Smashing Pumpkins.
Yeah. It's that same feeling from Jelly Belly of like, oh yeah, this is what I signed up for. This is why I bought this album, right?
Yeah, this is why I paid extra for the double album.
And so I could hear him scream Cage and I could feel tingly.
Yeah, and there's a lot of bands cover this. I can't remember what trailer I just saw. There was like, some cover. It was like a choir of this, Spy on My Rage.
The epic cover.
Around the Cage. Yeah.
I love the epic trailer versions of songs. It's great.
The original Rats in Your Cage chorus was born of the boredom sitting around at one of those overly dry BBC sessions. The thump riff that opens the song, a funny remnant of the first Siamese Dream recordings. There was always a lot of Frankenstein parts laying about. Then I'd mix and match back up together. Back when my real job was trying not to forget any inspiration that might come in handy later. All the way through 10 or so months of writing this and making this album, I thought this tune was both powerful and stupid. I could never really settle on one such opinion over the other. I would later be shocked when the record label announced that this song was to be their choice for the first single. I had to be talked into letting this happen by one cigar-chomping CEO who declared brazenly over the phone, "Kid, it's a smash." The song's true message had grown on me over the years, as I find it to be a withering attack on the lameness of fame. Who could have known then that the glory of fame would be even more important and ever-present commodity in the 21st century than it was in the face of the last? Mm.
Interesting.
Kid, it's a smash.
Kid, it's a smash. It's oh, that's so Hollywood. I fucking love it. I mean, this is, for me, this is kind of Billy doing what he does best, right? This is the Pumpkins basically taking a relatively standard hard rock song formula, a familiar chord progression, and just making it all just weird enough, right? just making small changes to it to kind of shuffle it up, and you're like, wow, this is something new. I didn't think they were gonna go there. I try to approach all of the analysis on these songs from like the scope of not having heard them, and with a song like this, it's hard because I've heard it a million times. But if you try to listen to it through new ears and like kind of filter it through expectations that the radio has given you, it's actually a fairly surprising song. It's a good tune.
So it's great song. I don't really know where else to go.
How about we then take a look at the next song, which I'm trying to pull up the title of, To Forgive.
All right, so how about if I'll start with the liner notes?
Let's hear what BC's
Billy has to say. The charitable act of forgiveness is made scarce mention of, but in that itself, it really stands as a lie. There's really nothing, and no one can be forgiven in the solemn halls of this song. It's more so a song of condemnation, the greatest which is reserved for the hand that writes it, who, despite knowing better, will carry the same destructive patterns as he learned in his youth into his own unnatural adult life. This is the kind of effort one only needs to make but once, and once is more than enough. Ta-da.
It's kind of a unique topic to kind of run into on a rock album. You don't usually get...
Especially the right after Despite All My Rage, I'm Still Just a Rat in the Cage.
And I'm sure that juxtaposition was very intentional. It's like, oh yeah, well, here, let's change up the tone and the message. I do like the sound of this song. There's parts of it that kind of remind me of the more ballady bits of Pink Floyd. It's not quite as like bombastic and showy as all of that, but it reminds me of some of their better songs, like some of their the good songwriting parts of their songs rather than the good musicianship mm-hmm. parts of their songs.
Yeah, for sure. I really like this one. Mellow, but still, it feels very autobiographical.
Yeah, and I feel like the lyrics don't feel so opaque.
Yeah, cool. Well, let's move on to An Ode to No One.
Once Upon a Time, titled Fuck You, I believe.
Yes, that was going to be the first thing I was going to mention, that originally it was called Fuck You, An Ode to No One, and the recent reissues have reverted that title back into circulation.
Doing the Lord's work.
Thank you, reissues.
Thank you for giving me my swears back.
So, in 1995, Corgan was asked by Rolling Stone who the song was directed towards, and he said, "The basic thing is fuck everybody. It's that feeling that no one understands. Who the fuck are my friends? Fuck you, fuck everybody, fuck everything. It's just that thought. Pure frustration."
Oh, that makes me like it even more.
Yeah. That's where the title comes from, I think.
Yeah, I don't feel like there's any mystery there at this point. That's great. It's to no one and also to everyone. That's fun. I think musically, this one kind of gets me in mind of like a proto Muse, if that makes sense. Like there's bits of this that sort of remind me of like a more gristly version of like Knights of Cydonia.
Yeah, I didn't make that connection until now, but yeah, that really works.
Yeah, so maybe Matt Bellamy owes Billy Corgan something for that, but yeah, it's theatrical and sort of the action movie kind of way, not in the show tune kind of way that some of like the big endings on Siamese Dream were.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you want to talk about the solo is pretty big in this, from what I've been reading.
So, I'd say, since you asked the question, tell me what you've heard about the solo.
Well, I have a quote about it. But, Billy says, for the solo in Fuck You, An Ode to No One, "I played until my fingers saw blood. You can't play a weak guitar solo in such a propulsive song. So it's got to be attack style." He explains this method by saying, "I put on the headphones and stand 1 foot away from the amp. I turn the amp up so loud that I literally have to play harder than the feedback, because if I stop playing for an instant, the whole thing explodes."
Yep. It's very much a chaos solo. Like his technique is there. His note selection is shockingly good for how much he's wrestling with the feedback and also just kind of keeping moving as fast as he can. It's all these, you know, hammer on pull off kind of deals, and but he takes that move and just moves all over the place with it. It's funny that specific movement that he's doing there. When I did the guitar solos for our theme song for this season, I do that move at probably about 30% of the speed that he does it there, right? You know, there's definitely some virtuosity on display. There's madness and genius in equal parts.
Do you want to hear the liner notes?
Yeah, absolutely.
"And jostling for attention in an era where the pit out front often dominated the focus of our evening's music, heavy songs were a must to both keep and control the crowd in short bursts of regulated energy. The more we traveled, the heavier we got. The heavier we got, the bigger the audience grew, until it was just this monster tipping over into once safe places, where chaos wasn't something you just went into the city and did, only later to forget about it in the safety of your room. Like the circus coming to town, we brought with us all the shadow elephants into the room, asking if they dance nice nightly for the amusement of all. Songs like this rode the razor's edge between nascent attraction and violence. With the blood of a spit lip, tastes good in your mouth. It took us forever to find and harness this kind of raw power. But once located and applied, it had this effect of separating the shades of each night into different radical hues.
Hmm. Well, I mean, I definitely think the... So, like, for me, Jelly Belly was one of the heaviest ones I'd heard from them up to this point, yeah. Right? You know, if we're talking chronologically. But that was much more, like, sort of punky and chaotic, especially mm-hmm. with that intro. This one is... I'd say similarly heavy, but it's got a certain precision to it. I like that the quote in there yet about, like, you know, intense regulated bursts of energy or whatever that was.
Yeah.
You know, like that's quite apt. But yeah, this song kicks ass, and I love that it continues to end. It has like four endings at the end, and I'm like, yeah, more, do another,
more, do end it again,
again.
All right, you want to move on to the next song?
Love.
Love.
This is a weird one. This is a weird one.
Yeah.
I mean, pretty much the entirety of the guitar track's like running through a phaser, so like the whole thing sounds like you're kind of in a barrel, but I mean, that's a very intentional choice. This is the one that, to mm-hmm. me, feels the most 90s, if that makes sense.
Okay.
And I'm not necessarily talking about 90s rock so much as 90s pop.
Sure. No, yeah, I get that. It's, I think, Garbage.
Yes.
It sounds very much like Garbage, which I think still came much later. But, yeah, this is kind of the sound that reminds me of Garbage.
Yeah, I was also thinking of Garbage as well. And, I mean, there's the connection there with Butch Vig, so...
But Butch didn't do this album.
No, I know he didn't. I have no idea who did it. All I know is it doesn't sound like Butch did it. But he did the last two with him.
Well, Brian, if you were listening during my history segment instead of just drinking, it was Flood and Alan Mulder.
Okay. So in that case, we're seeing some production overlap from Nine Inch Nails, which makes sense to why this one also gave me some Nine Inch Nails-y vibes. So.
Yeah. Yeah. So... Yeah, because Flood had already done Pretty Hate Machine and Broken
yep.
at this point. If you want to hear more about those albums, you should check out our first series on Nine Inch Nails. Shameless
it's
plug.
Good.
All right. So liner notes. A straight up blues where I moan and drone about the confusing complexities of L-O-V-E whenever sex is applied as cause and effect. The word love is used low here, for if in being lucky and used lowly enough, love too becomes a useful device in the high arts of illumination. Straight up, the song rocked, but by smearing the voice and cyber affixing the drums, it takes on a mocking tone that distracts from the very real fear hidden in it. Vagina dentata. Love represented here is both oppressive and inescapable, an unrelenting god that won't let go until you are... spent and hollowed O-U-T. The vagina dentata thing was just, it's literally two
you
words.
You just put it in as its own sentence in the middle of it.
It's its own sentence,
And I'm sure he's using it as a metaphor for, like, the, you know, the dangers of sex, right? You get bit by it, right? You know, you're in there for a good time, but then you get caught in your feels after and all that kind of deal. Now, it's a two-edged sword, vagina dentata being Latin for toothed vagina.
Toothed. Yeah. That's something I need to remove from my Google search history.
Do me a favor, man. Don't ever watch the film Teeth.
Okay, I'm good.
Yep. Heed that warning.
So, did you have anything to say about this, the song or the liner notes? Anything else?
I mean, he's definitely waxing a little more poetic in these liner notes than in some of the you know, the previous ones on this record, but that's okay. You know, it's a bit of a return to form. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I really appreciate getting those weird, you know, kind of more, you know, nebulous ones that he puts out.
Yeah.
Because they do provide a little bit of context for the lyrics. And I find that so often I am listening so much more closely to the instruments with this band than I am to the lyrics. And so it's mm-hmm. nice to kind of get that extra layer of just sort of context and meaning.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, this one, it's, like he said, yeah, I think it's actually pretty spot on. It's a blues song, just kind of gone wrong.
All right, next we have Cupid Deluxe.
Holy shit, where did this come from?
Yeah, this is this the most un-Pumpkins that we've heard
it's
so
like
far?
It's like synthy, it's orchestral, albums? It stays major for pretty much the whole song, it's gorgeous, the vocals are clearly intelligible.
Yeah.
None of that is what I signed up for.
Like, it's kind of maybe hinted at in the opening track and
yeah,
tonight, but
I mean, but at that point we've
I was not expecting seven songs
to forget it, right? One, two, yeah. Yeah, no, it's been seven tracks since we had the last, you know, sort of pretty one that wasn't, you know, To Forgive, which was still a dark ballad. Then this just comes out of nowhere. It's bright and magical. And it's full of those myths and unicorns he was talking about when he turned 27.
Yeah, it's so the title is a reference to Matthew Locke, an English Baroque composer during the 17th century who wrote a score to a mosque entitled Cupid and Death, which is a story about Cupid and Death getting their arrows mixed up and causing great distress and humor to ensue. Which is pretty, if you listen to the lyrics, is pretty much
yeah,
what's
dead
going
on. Yeah.
Yeah. We in the liner notes, let's see, to counterbalance our many dark excursions into the void, I sought some refuge by writing whimsically as well, finding solace in twirling parasols and the extant lingering passions of the belle epoque. Love is held in the ideal, driven up high above a nasty world that held glorious in places of unmistakable faith. In a rare fit of fun, we even recorded whispering aerosol cans and haughty rusted scissor snips to build up an unusual kaleidoscope of chorus around the semi-chromatic wheeze of the synth. That was a long sentence.
Sure was.
Not a note is played by a human, as it were, being each part fed through a phalanx of mystery boxes, which, when twisted and turned just right, spit back out a different set of warbles than the funny marbles do you put in. In a humble nod to Elvis, there's even a spoken poem of dedication that lilts out on the gallop, for I couldn't help myself but rap fully in the cloak of a sincere and innocent lover.
Well, that had both. That had the whimsy and the information. I love that about them using the aerosol cans and the scissors to build up the percussion. I didn't even realize.
Yeah, and feeding that
when you typed that, I started immediately scanning through the song on the earbud, like, where are they? Where are they? I think I'm picking them up toward the end. Really cool. But also, classic Billy.
Yep. Okay, one quick thing.
Yeah.
If you say that you're making a humble nod to something, does that make you, doesn't that take away from the humility of it if you mention how humble you are?
I mean, in the words of the great Weird Al Yankovic, you think you're really humble, you think you're pure of heart. Well, I know I'm a million times as humble as thou art.
Perfect.
There's no reason to leave that in the show. I think that sort of backpedals it, but I think, I mean, of course, when he's saying it that way, I think he's sort of phrasing it as a thank you to the influence.
Okay.
But, right. You know, right. So I mean, like, it's a mixed bag. I don't know.
Okay. Well, next song is Galapagos.
So we have ourselves another ballad. Another one that gives me some more Pink Floyd-y vibes. Actually,
yeah.
Floyd intensifies here.
So, you want to know what Billy has to say about in the liner notes?
Yes.
Just say no. Please say no so I don't have to read any more of these.
Tyler.
No.
Vivid detail, please.
Okay.
People listen to this podcast for vivid detail. God damn it.
Look, I get it. We have this episode this month and then next month, and then we won't have any more reissue liner notes. So we'll milk these for what we can get. All right. I cannot recall what it was about Darwin's fabled set of islands that led me to associate my crumbling marriage to him. Perhaps I was wondering if in the lure of a total and disconnected isolation, we might better survive the onslaught of life's ceaseless progress. Idolizing a failed romance can only get you so far, and once engaged, I found out that somewhere between my idealism and natural compassion for an identified other, there lived a truth I was not yet willing to swallow about myself. I swear he must like voice dictate these because, or something. Or no, he'd like type these out because you can't talk. It's like Harrison Ford's telling George Lucas, you can write this stuff, but you can't say it.
Here's the one thing I will say. I think you're right, but at the same time, I think Billy talks this way. I think he absolutely talks this way. I've seen very limited interviews with him, but when he's talking about all of his guitars in that interview for the recording of Siamese Dream, and he's like, "And where's the happy guitar?" And he's like, "Oh, it's this one right here. It brings great joy to a good many people." You know, I think he just talks like this. He's a poetic man.
All right, it's the run on sentences that I have to regurgitate. But there is more.
Keep it coming. Pour it down my gullet.
Okay. All right. Cue up my admitting here that one of us is about to be abandoned, never realizing that the desertion would flow both ways. Galapagos stands up over time as a remnant of grace that I lost as I wrote it.
That's a pretty powerful line to end on.
Yeah.
Almost like he was exchanging grace to make the piece of art. Wow. Yeah, that's quite a notion.
But there's something about the way he sings this. It feels very genuine and very personal.
It's also very unadorned, right? Like the way that it's produced. Mm-hmm. It's very dry. It's very naked. And he's not pushing. He's not pushing real hard on the vocals. He's there to get the notes out and for you to feel what he's feeling, and it works. It's a tremendously effective song. Two ballady ones that we've run into thus far, favorite ballad.
Yeah, I think so. I think I agree with that.
I do like To Forgive, but I prefer this song. It's also got some interesting like elements from songs that are heavier than it. Right, you know, it's got that little twin lead break towards like the, you know, like the two-third of the way into the song. And, you know, it's again him repurposing things that you're used to in one context and spinning them. And I'm here for that.
All right, let's move on to Muzzle. It's kind of a return to form for what the album was earlier.
Yeah, I also see this one as probably one of the most Siamese Dream-y tracks on there. It feels like it would be very much at home there, and as a matter of fact, I wouldn't be surprised if it was written during that batch of songs. I don't know if he perhaps elucidates in the liner notes, but
well, he says, first of all, just to answer that question, no, it doesn't say that it was written during Siamese, but written first on the piano in my crude Lennon-ish tinker toy style. This song, possibly more than any other in the collection, demonstrates the power of old band collective to convert up ideas rapidly. From doleful sea shanties to epic rockets, it took me nearly a month to convince Jimmy to play with such joyful abandon in his fills, and I cited the great Big Star as an example where playing loose doesn't necessarily mean playing poorly. Mm-hmm. This notion opened up to a whole new galaxy to Jimmy's drumming, where emotional expressionism took priority, vaunted technical precision.
Mm-hmm.
Somewhere in my mind, I was thinking of Bobby D repeating the core themes with a variation at the end, but it is a leftover memory of a clever song device from a source I can never recall. The idea of Muzzle refers to thinking of my life would be far simpler if I kept my trap shut.
Well, I mean, that's a deeply relatable feeling.
Yep.
I mean, this one feels formative. I feel like a lot of 90s alt-rock really, more the alt-pop stuff, not the stuff you would hear on Sacramento terms, 106.5 versus 100.5. when we were growing up. God, that's specific for our listeners. Anyway, there was a hard rock alternative station and then sort of an alternative pop rock station. And that this seems to be kind of much more in that other direction there. And you know, there was a lot of stuff happening concurrently with this that was in that vein, but this was sort of a better executed version of a lot of it.
Like I said, I think this is a good kind of return to what the style that we were listening to earlier. I do like the Icarus reference with, I knew exactly where I was. I knew the meaning of it all. And I knew the distance to the sun.
Mm-hmm. And I love that because he does everything but say it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just a little hint of what he's talking about, not saying it directly. I don't know why, but I always love me a good Icarus reference.
Absolutely. And so often those references end up being using the name or saying flew too close to the sun in that particular phrase. Yeah. He skirted around it, and I respect that hard.
All right. Do you have anything else for this?
No. Muzzle me.
Okay. I've been trying, Brian.
Good luck.
So next we have Porcelina of the Vast Oceans. So this one we get a nice long, like, 3-minute intro.
Yeah.
Before we get to the actual song, but it's leaving that muzzle sound at first, but then it just starts ripping into it.
Oh yeah, I mean this is another one. I think I used the phrase, you know, Kool-Aid Manning through the wall on the last technical analysis. This does that. You're so calm, and then all of a sudden, the fucking bomb explodes.
Do you want to try out these liner notes?
You know what? I'm a little terrified because this is a 9-plus-minute song, so I'm assuming it's a small novel, but let's hit it.
All right. On our first two albums, we've grown accustomed to the benefit of playing many songs live long before they had been crystallized on tape. Once stuck in the gut of so many ideas, I suggested we consider playing a few hometown shows to hammer out some kinks, as well as force the dubious pretenders among us into the light. This made plenty of sense to everyone, save for the fact that very few of the 50-plus songs we were working on at any given time had any true lyrics by which I might sing in a show. Only 72 hours before the first of four planned such dates, I found myself with about 400 lines to fill and very little idea of what I might want to say, if indeed I wanted to say anything at all. I raced my way through various spiraled notebooks, compiling a sort of master syllabus of lines and fragmented poems that I jotted down through my travails. What came out in haste was a sort of running screed where common ideas spilled over one another until I wasn't sure what any of the songs were really about. I ended up keeping most of what I'd scrawled in that moment of compression and pressure, and you can see that most clearly in a song like Porcelina, where vague allusions and to the mythic tides and sinking ships seem to be only enhance the unconscious feelings within. Carl Jung would be proud. As much as I want every line of every song to be perfect, there is something perfect about not fussing over anything too much, letting synchronicity be a teacher and guide to the stars.
So here I'll respond to that as somebody who also writes songs. I feel challenged by that. I feel like I'm being called out because I always overthink
personally
my lyrics
attacked.
Way too hard. Personally attacked. That's the phrase. Because it's really easy to want to make sure that absolutely everything is inch perfect, because for the most part, the lyrics are what everyone's going to remember more than anything. But with a band like this, where the instrumentalists are so damn good that oftentimes the vocals take a back seat, then...
Yeah, I think I remember more Smashing Pumpkins sounds, instruments, than I do lyrics.
And I feel like that's true of just about anybody I know who has really spent some time with the band, that they never really thought about the lyrics. They're just like, oh, I love this song.
Yeah.
That's it, you know? I absolutely love the journey that this song goes on. It covers so much ground, and this is falling into a rather tired cliche of Brian liking the longest song on the Smashing Pumpkins album, but I will say that this one is my favorite. It's so, so deeply interesting, and it's so varied. But it does follow sort of a familiar pop structure. He's doing the stuff that I like it best when he does.
I think I totally see that. Like Smashing Pumpkins, something about them, if you give them 10 minutes, they will take you on a journey every on a single track. And I don't know what other, there's very few other bands, I think, that can do that.
Well, I mean, it's...
Or at least try to do
it's
that.
It's just so hard to hold attention for that long, and they make it sound easy.
Yeah. Yep. So, yeah, go Smashing Pumpkins.
Woohoo! Billy! And then I believe this All takes right. us to the last song on this half of the record, yes?
Yes, Take Me Down. My main note that I wrote for this is James Iha can sing a. Because James Iha sings this one.
Yes. Now I have to ask, when you type that, did you say S-I-N-G-A or G-H-A?
S-I-N-G-H-A.
I'm pretty sure that's a beer from Thailand. I'm doing it right now. Yeah, okay. No, it's a beer. It's a beer from somewhere.
Well,
anyway, Thailand. Yeah,
completely separate. Yeah.
Sorry. But yeah, he can, and I actually really love that he's doing that. I was worried that Billy wasn't ever going to let anybody else take another step after Darcy sang "Daydream" at the end of "Gitch."
Yeah,
but it's especially on an album of this sort of depth and breadth, it's really refreshing just to have another voice in there. James has a much like kind of purer tone, and it fits the sweet nature of the song, you know, sonically.
Mm-hmm. And he did write this one as well, not just sing it. So you want to hear what Billy has to say about somebody else's song?
Well, this should be interesting. Yes, do tell.
All right. So with 7 years in on the band, James had expressed interest in singing his own songs rather than just contribute ideas, which I might help develop into my own. There's real enthusiasm and support around him in hopes that he might chart his own path as a singer-songwriter as long as what he brought to the band was strong. Take Me Down was a tune I personally felt worthy of inclusion from the start, but in the process of fleshing out its varying ideas, the rest of us became moribund on a dreary aisle. It's fair to say that there are many songs on Mellon Collie that are not band efforts per se, where in pursuing a particular feeling, I wanted my singular ideas included as part of the work as a greater whole. In the end of Take Me Down became a different kind of solo effort, because James would not allow his song to be transmuted from its primary colors by the band, and we did work on it endlessly as a group, perhaps spending more time on this than any other in the studio. As such, when we finished the album, I sequenced it towards the end of record one, because it thematically fit in nowhere I could find. Although sonically its drowsiness had echoes elsewhere, James saw the demotion of his favorite track to the back of the line as an unforgivable slight, killing his desire to contribute to the band as a writer of note from that moment on.
Well, I mean, that's rather telling, you know? The dynamics of being in a song with more than one person who writes, it's a difficult thing. And that's sort of the situation with the band that I play in. There's two primary songwriters. Mm-hmm. I have, you know, chipped in lyrics for one song. And it's not a song that's, you know, a single or, you know, rather important one to the album. I don't see it as a slight. You know, we had a space to fill in the album, and I was like, well, thematically we're mm-hmm. trying to do this, so I'll write this. Yeah. But I can feel how that would be perhaps frustrating for James, sort of being in his shadow, you know?
Yeah.
Especially being as talented as he is, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, the dynamics of that, when there's been primarily one singer-songwriter and then someone else is in the mix within the same group, it can be a very, very awkward, you know, fatal thing for a band.
I know that for a totally other, different, completely different band, when Dave Grohl joined Nirvana, mm-hmm. he'd been writing songs and playing guitar on his own. And it took him a long time to even approach Kurt Cobain with like, hey, I have a song, mm-hmm. because he didn't want to be that stereotypical drummer who's like, hey guys, I've got a song.
Also known as, what is the last thing a drummer says in a band? Hey guys, yeah. Let's try one of mine.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I think that's a pretty common thing.
Yeah.
Being a second or third songwriter in a band that already has established songwriters.
That being said, I think it's a lovely song and a nice sedate ending to the first half of the record.
Yeah. Yeah. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was great. It really in the vein of like Daydream.
Yeah.
From Gesh. Do you want to talk about this half or this album or half of an album as a whole? Do you want to dive into that at all?
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's worth discussing this as a unit by itself before we do that in the context of the full album at the end of the next episode. I feel like this is their, if we're treating this as one album here, right? This first half is its own album.
Yeah.
Probably their most eclectic release to date. Very, very easily so. There are some things I absolutely love about the songwriting. On the heavier songs, I miss Butch Vig's production. I miss the punchy clarity of his production. Some of this is a little more chaotic, and that's not to say it sounds bad. It's just that they had a little bit of a consistent sound that I was really digging, and then this one's it's a little bit darker. And it works. Mm-hmm. I'm personally having a hard time emotionally moving on from Siamese Dream.
Okay. I do think that I think I enjoy Siamese Dream more still, but I do really like this sequence or these 14 songs in this order. I think it's kind of a step in maturing, either in whether it's the lyrics or the instrumentals. It sounds like a more mature band than what we got in Siamese Dream.
Yeah.
And so I think if you had to make this its own standalone album, I think it could work and I would enjoy it as a whole.
Yeah. With it being half of an album, it makes sense. But I mean, Siamese Dream feels more complete to me than this first half does. And I do agree with you that I think in general, I like Siamese Dream better than this, at least this first half of the album. But I will say that some of the stuff on here, like Porcelina and Keep It to Lock, some of like weirder, softer, more cerebral stuff is like some of my favorite stuff that I've heard from him to date. Both of those songs absolutely knocked me on my ass.
Yeah, especially how different they were from what we're expecting.
Yeah.
But I really have tried to not listen to too much of the next half.
Me too.
And until we recorded this, so I'm really looking forward to doing that now and seeing what the second half has in store.
Yeah, me too.
But before we wrap up everything, we have a few listener feedback. Mm-hmm. The first one comes from Reddit. I'm going to try and say their name to give credit. Wayfive, WAIFIVE from Reddit. And they say, maybe considering giving Zwayne a quick overview like you did with Pisces Iscariot, which as Zwayne is the side band for Billy Corgan, that will be coming up soon. And then they also say, what about the two big singles that weren't on any album, Drown, and The End Is the Beginning Is the End from the Batman and Robin soundtrack? I understand if you want to stick to albums as a rule, but I suppose you're already past Drown. Well, then never mind then. Give it a listen. It's a fan favorite, an important formative song. And it was the one song Corgan was hoping he wouldn't have to move off of Gish when Cameron Crowe approached him about putting a Smashing Pumpkins song on the singles soundtrack.
Well, there we go. Well, I personally have not heard Drown, so I'll have to listen to that now and the next episode.
It's on the Rotten Apples Best of Greatest Hits. So I know I heard it, and as soon as I heard it, I played the track after reading that. I was like, oh yeah, I know this song. It's a really good song. It's from the Gish era, but it feels more mature. Like it feels like it could be Siamese Dream, like that one step more mature. Really good song. I'll put it in the show notes so Brian can listen to it on his own time.
Thanks.
And then so the beginning,
the end is the beginning is the end.
Yes. The song that I can never say correctly. This is one that has been on my iPod for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
This is
from the Batman and Robin soundtrack.
It is a Batman movie.
It is an Batman movie. Complete with batnips.
I like this song. I'm one of the people who actually likes the remix version that shows up in the Watchmen soundtrack later on.
Which I believe is actually called The Beginning Is the End Is the Beginning when it's remixed.
Yes. which is probably why I'm always mixed up on everything. Yeah. But yeah, both versions of the songs are great. Yeah. And this does technically happen after Mellon Collie, but we wanted to talk about it now because we're not going to be able to get to it if we try and save it for next month. Next month is going to be so much bigger.
It's going to be such a long episode.
Make room on your iPods, everybody.
Yeah, absolutely. For this one though, for the end is the beginning is the end. My main note on this one is that this is them kind of using spooky sounds in terms of which notes that they're picking, probably for one of the first times ever, because most of what they're doing lies very well within functional harmony. Maybe they're switching to, like, you know, a different key or a different scale or something like that. And this one, they're intentionally using some notes that are nasty just for the effect. And I love that. It's in spite of it having sort of a polished poppy driving sort of lilt to it, the underpinnings of it are probably some of the most, like, dark metally kind of sounds that they've got going on beneath it. So it's sort of a wolf in sheep's clothing, and I enjoy that. So we did receive a comment on our call and response on Facebook. For anonymity purposes, we will omit your name, but thank you very much for your comment. The comment says, I love how diverse the song styles are, personally. The music videos that spawned from the album, especially Tonight Tonight and 33, were so gorgeous and game-changing. They both stand the test of time. Tyler, we haven't gotten to 33 yet, so I guess that gives me some time to kind of watch the videos for the singles before next week, but... Yeah. I definitely agree with the general sentiment there. That one of the strong points of this record is how eclectic it is.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, thank you for your comment, and I feel weird not thanking you by name, but anonymity.
All right, I did for that same post on that we put on Twitter. We got a response from another podcast, Pod Like a Hole, who. They did their own Nine Inch Nails series, and they're currently doing a David Bowie series.
Oh yeah,
if you want to check them out. But so they said, I saw them live for that tour when they played 1979, and they played B-roll and outtakes from the excellent music video on the projector behind them. So that was kind of their one of their favorite aspects of the album.
Well, and you know, we'll get to that song next week, but that's. A masterpiece in its own right. We'll get there, but do want to say a quick howdy and thank you to, as they have put it, our neighbors across the street in Pod Like a Hole, another music podcast that we're happy to be sharing airwaves with.
All right, so this is the part of the show where, as we're wrapping up, we kind of mention maybe an album or something that we've been listening to that isn't Smashing Pumpkins, but like. You know, just something that we've been listening to or maybe connects to this album in some way. Brian, what's on your old recommendation list?
Okay, so I've got a habit of recommending things that aren't, like, necessarily super thematically or stylistically in line with what our source material is for the week.
Which is fine.
That's something I plan to continue. I'd like to recommend, and this is going to be a bit of deja vu here, the most recent album from The National. I recommended their previous album at some point early in the Nine Inch Nails series that we did, but they just came out with a new one like 5 days ago. And it is called I Am Easy to Find. It is... a very, very unique album. The instrumentation is not at all what I was expecting. And this is a band that has primarily had one vocalist for its entire, you know, career. And they have a lot of female vocalists come in and sing with him over the course of this record, oftentimes taking songs almost all to their own, where he is putting a lot of effort into the writing of the songs, but sort of letting other voices that perhaps suit the tone of the story better sing them. And it's a weird one. There's a couple of songs that I don't like as much as some of the others, but that's kind of been my experience with this band, is that upon first listen of a new record, I'm not a huge fan of it. And then it just claws its way into my brain and becomes a favorite. So...
you had me at, it's a weird one. So yeah, I'll check it out. Yep. So yours was completely different thematically from what we were talking about with Mellon Collie, but I decided to go with one of my favorite double albums. Is In Your Honor by the Foo Fighters.
Hell yeah.
It's a great, basically there's two sides. First side is all the rock songs, loud and in your face. And the second half is just acoustic songs. And they're completely different songs. It's two different.
Oh yeah. It's not acoustic versions of the songs from the first, right? Correct. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. If you like loud Foo Fighters, this is your album. If you like quiet, mellow Foo Fighters, this is your album.
And the drummer sings one. Taylor gets to sing one song on this record, and it's a fun one.
Yes, and that's one of my favorite songs by Foo Fighters.
Yeah, I'll second that. I love that.
So one thing that I do want to mention is in our show notes, I've been putting, in the last episode, I started putting Amazon affiliate links to some of the stuff we talk about, whether it's the main album, you know, Mellon Collie, or the bands that we recommend in this section here. But it's kind of a way to support us. You can either go to Patreon and do kind of like a monthly subscription thing where you throw us a dollar, or even if you just go in and click on these links, you can either buy the album that we talked about that's in the link, or I guess there's even it'll kind of track you if you allow it. So where if you just do your normal Amazon shopping, you go through our link and then do your normal Amazon shopping, you don't pay anything extra, but it gives us a little kickback. So that would be a cool way to help us out. That doesn't cost you anything if you are already using Amazon.
So I mean that does help us to be able to do, eventually over time, to be able to kind of invest that back into the podcast and hopefully offer you even more as a listener.
If you want to get a hold of us and send us some cool messages about what you think about things that we talked about, you can email us discographers@gmail.com.
You can find us on Twitter at discographerpod.
We have facebook.com/discographers.
soundcloud.com/the-discographers.
And then, like I mentioned earlier, if you want to throw us a few dollars once a month, patreon.com/thediscographers.
And just as a reminder, on Patreon, we had made an offer for Tyler to review a sandwich while I do an acapella cover of a techno song. And that is something that only that new donor will get access to. Think of all you're missing.
And then we're also doing this thing where I need outro music to end the podcast with. So if you want to have your music played, you can send me your stuff. Email me something and I will probably play it. Right now, I don't know what I'm going to play in next month's episode. So it'd be kind of cool if we had something lined up. The outro music for this month is Future Ghost Stories by the artist XC. And you can check out that link in the show notes. Check out the rest of their stuff. There's a lot of really good music there. So, bye, everybody.
Have a good one.